Penguin Random House Audio presents The Paper Solution. What to shred, what to save, and how to stop it from taking over your life. By Lisa K. Woodruff with Mary Nolan Pleckham. This is the author, Lisa K. Woodruff. A note to listeners. This program includes a bonus PDF that contains an appendix of worksheets from the book. Author's note. The stories in The Paper Solution are all true, and they're gleaned from my personal experiences, the stories of clients I've worked with, and anecdotes that podcast listeners and Organized 365 community members have shared with me. Some of the identifying characteristics have been changed in certain stories, and a few stories have been combined in the editing process. But it's important to me that you know that you're not alone in dealing with the paper tsunami in your life. This is an issue in homes and with families everywhere. And the good news? There's a solution. Listen on. To my husband, Greg, and our children, Joey and Abby, you make our house a home. Part 1. We are drowning in paper. Chapter 1. The Paper Tsunami. Why paper is so important, and how to keep much, much less of it. A paper tsunami is coming, and we need to be ready. Some of us have already experienced it, and many more will soon face the deluge. Our houses are full of paper. Our parents' houses are full of paper. And some of us have grandparents' houses full of paper, too. That's generations of clutter waiting to crash down on our unsuspecting heads. But there's a better way. You can ditch the filing cabinets stuffed full of documents that you may or may not ever need to look at again. You can find the papers that you do need easily, effortlessly, and without stress or drama. You can create a system for organizing your paper that actually works for you, not against you. I know, because I was once where you are sitting right now, staring down a paper tsunami filled with dread and uncertainty. And I've come out the other side. Why I care so much about paper. My name is Lisa Woodruff. Yes, I'm one of those crazy productive, ultra-organized people you love to hate. Yep, I was born that way. My closets were always neatly organized, and I live for a finished to-do list. Sorry. But even I found myself completely flummoxed and overwhelmed when it came to dealing with one particular type of clutter, paper. My own personal paper tsunami came at one of the most chaotic times in my life. In the spring of 2009, my father, after being ill for 9 months, was sent home with hospice care. He died just a few short days later. As I made the final 4-hour drive home, I kept my mind busy making lists upon lists. My sister and I would need to make funeral arrangements. The house needed to be cleaned, its contents dispersed and sold. Sooner rather than later was best, since neither of us had the means to hold on to it. The to-dos involved with settling an estate were overwhelming. A quick Google search helped with all but one major question. What to do with all the paper? My father's house contained a lifetime of paper, and each file would need to be sorted to settle the estate. Paper is tedious. The precious few days I had at my father's house were not enough to figure out what to do with each piece of paper, so I swept it all up and brought it home. Boxes and boxes of paper. With my sister finishing the physical distribution and sale of the family home, I set to work settling the estate paperwork. I never felt as overwhelmed as when I went through my father's files. Part of me felt like I was invading his privacy, worried I would find something he didn't want me to see. Likewise, it was hard for me to simply trash some of the paperwork that was precious to him, but meaningless to me, like his car catalog collections. Oh, those car catalogs. Beautiful cars were Dad's passion, and he kept meticulous files full of bulky paperwork all about them. Cars he'd owned decades ago, cars he wanted to own one day. That collection was his pride and joy, even though it had no monetary value or purpose. It was also the bane of my existence. So what happened to the bulk of Dad's papers? They sat there, in my home. Taking up physical space, yes, but more important, taking up precious mental and emotional real estate. My home was filled with my father's files and boxes of memories that I didn't know how to process or enjoy. Every day was filled with anxiety. Something had to give. On New Year's Day, 2012, that's almost 3 years after Dad's papers landed in my house, for those of you keeping score, I made a vow to finally get all that paper in order. That included dealing with my own paper as well as my father's. Because I found very few books or resources that specifically addressed how to organize paper, I soon realized I was on my own. I took a deep breath, dug in, and for the next 3 months, through trial and a lot of error, I dealt with the paper, sheet by sheet. Even those out-of-date car catalogs, which I recycled in the end. Eventually, my home became close to being manageable again. I turned my paper problem into the paper solution. I started blogging about my experience with the goal of sharing advice with others facing the same sort of paper crisis. And people really responded. Some of them were like me, cleaning out a family house or a loved one's estate. Others were simply overwhelmed by the school forms, monthly bills, medical forms, and other detritus of everyday life. My blog, Organize 365, spawned a newsletter that attracted tens of thousands of devoted fans, then a hit podcast, and eventually a thriving business. Here's what I realized. Although people interested in decluttering can find plenty of videos, books, and other resources about how to get rid of extra clothes, housewares, and junk, no one was talking specifically about how to organize paper. And yet paper is one of the most common and anxiety-producing kinds of clutter that most of us have to deal with. Why is that? What is it about paper? Paper is the bane of most people's existence. Even the most organized person will break out in a cold sweat at the thought of sorting a mountain of paperwork. So why is it so hard for even otherwise tidy people to get their heads around their paperwork? For starters, it's the sheer volume of paper we're all faced with on a daily basis. When personal computers were first developed, we were promised they would lead to a society with less paper. But 40-plus years later, we're still not there. Although the paperless office was first proposed in a Business Week article way back in 1975, today the average office worker is still estimated to come in contact with about 10,000 pieces of paper every year. And we're not just overwhelmed with paper at work. Americans face a daily deluge of paper at home, too. It comes in the mail. Kids bring it home from school. Our activities send out newsletters and calendars. And we often get behind in its management. The average American household processes a paper stack as high as a two-story house every year. And the paper keeps coming. The United States Postal Service delivers over 484 million pieces of mail each day. The majority of the 4 million tons of junk mail that Americans receive annually ends up in landfills. This does not even begin to include the heavy amount of paper that we actually want or need to keep. Paper is not pretty. It's not fun. It is practical. But it can also be tedious, and nerve-wracking. Paper piles are easily hidden, at first. For a long time, I debated with myself about how long I should save different papers, where to file papers I wanted to be able to retrieve, and why I couldn't find a particular paper. It was a waste of time, and it was stressful. And that stress builds up over time, until those piles just can't be ignored. Although we desperately long for the paperless future, we are not there. No matter how electronic our lives become, we will always be dealing with paper.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.